वेलकम टू ईपीजी पाठशाला। आई एम तनुश्री चौधरी फ्रॉम एनएसआईटी नेताजी सुभाष इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ दिल्ली। टुडे विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट कल्चर आइडियोलॉजी एंड टेक्नोलॉजी इन द लाइट ऑफ कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशंस मेड बाय लुइस अल्थुसर, वाल्टर बेंजामिन एंड जोनाथन डॉलीमोर। द टर्म कल्चर हैविंग इट्स ओरिजिन फ्रॉम कल्चरा एंड कोलेरे, meaning to cultivate, has developed into the web of generated meanings and ideas in the prevailing site of power relations. The extension from canonized works of literature to pamphlets, different kinds of documents, comes into the continuous struggle in the policies of culture. Stuart Hall's essay, Cultural Studies, you have to go back. You know that politics is always being read as policies. The term culture, having its origin from cultura and colere, meaning to cultivate, has developed into the web of generated meanings and ideas in the prevailing site of power relations. The extension from canonized works of literature to pamphlets, different kinds of documents, comes into the continuous struggle in the politics of culture. Culture, according to Stuart Hall, is a debating site that can never be registered for one side or the other. It is a complex process where meanings are negotiated in terms of power relations, where certain class govern meanings, where meanings are subverted in the culture of masses, and it is seen pejoratively. Stuart Hall's essay, Cultural Studies, Two Paradigms, sees the distinction between high and low culture and the ideological hegemony of the dominant classes to reinterpret the power structures in society. The Center for Contemporary Culture Studies at the University of Birmingham in Great Britain develops critical ideas of several ideologies in several schools of thought. Marxist scholars like Theodore Adorno, Marx, Horkheimer, Walter Benjamin, Louis Althusser and Raymond Williams in their works decipher ideology, production, mechanized reproduction, economic and social fabrics to figure out how culture is produced. What constitutes the culture of a community? Which cultural artifact produces meaning in the so-called culture industry in a society? They also emphasize the relationship between politics and literature, ideology and hegemony, and the relationship of literature with technologies that control society. Such studies govern concerns with issues like ideology, race, identity, and subcultures which remain hidden in the present culture, parent culture. Raymond Williams in Culture is Ordinary emphasizes that culture is ordinary. That is the first fact. Every human society has its own shape, its own purposes, its own meanings. Every human society expresses these in institutions and in arts and learning. The making of society is the finding of common meanings and directions. And its growth is an active debate and amendment under the pressures of experience, contact, and discovery, writing themselves into the land. So, culture is the cumulative effect of social, economic, mechanical, and ideological dynamics that make us understand that prevailing conditions are natural. Now, we'll be talking about how literature is read to get information about culture. To read culture is to read culture. That is to read literature, but to understand literature, we have to be conscious about culture. Raymond Williams in The Long Revolution analyzes culture and society. Our description of our experience comes to compose a network of relationships. And all our communication systems, including the arts, are literally parts of a social organization. Since our way of seeing is literally our way of living, the process of communication is, in fact, the process of community. The offering, reception, and comparison of new meanings, leading to the tensions and achievements of growth and change. Louis Althusser, a French structural Marxist thinker, is one of the most important theoreticians in France. He influenced Marxist literary theory, and his influence on the concept of ideology is the most influential aspect of his work in literary and cultural studies. His ideas are related to the notion of ideology, that is, a representation of the imaginary relationship of individuals to the real conditions of existence. Actors are pointed that ideology does not portray the real world, but paints the imaginary relationship of individuals to the actual world. Ideology is twice removed from the real, like Lacan's imaginary order is to be real. Althusser elaborated his concept of ideology in four marks. He says, an ideology is a system with its own logic and rigor of representations, which include images, myths, ideas or concepts, depending on the case, endowed with a historical existence and a role within a given society. Ideology as a system of representations is distinguished from science in that in it the practico-social function is more important than the theoretical function as knowledge, which is contained in four marks on page 231. Ideology is a kind of discourse of which we are not conscious. Rather, it amounts to the stream of discourses. Images, ideas will live and breathe only to develop into unconscious happening. He writes, ideology is indeed a system of representations, but in the majority of cases, these representations have nothing to do with consciousness. They are usually images and occasionally concepts, but it's above all as structures that they impose on the vast majority of men, not via their consciousness. They are perceived, accepted, suffered, cultural objects, and they act functionally on men via a process that escapes them. He exemplified the idea of ideological state apparatuses for the materialistic conception of ideology, only to find proclamation that ideology has no history, while individual ideologies are embedded in histories and the common form of ideology is peripheral to history. His thesis, ideology has a material existence, expressed his notion of materialistic social practices that stressed the fact that ideologies are achieved through our actions and practices, which find resonance in Marx's concept of practical materialism. Ideology lives only in the material practices of material apparatuses. For French Marxist critic Louis Althusser, the function of ideology in life, how it is produced and flourished through the state apparatuses, constitutes the dynamics of repressive and ideological state apparatuses. Reproduction of labor power and relations of productions under the subjection of ruling class with a ruling ideology shapes patterns of circulation and consumption produced away from the factory in actual relations of labor. He put it scientifically in the essay Ideology and Ideological State Apparatuses. To put this more scientifically, I shall say that the reproduction of labor power requires only a reproduction of the skills, but also at the same time a reproduction of its submission to the rules of the established order. That is, a reproduction of submission to the ruling ideology for the workers, and reproduction of the ability to manipulate the ruling ideology correctly for the agents of exploitation and repression, so that they too will provide for the domination of the ruling class in words. Althusser worked with the base superstructure metaphor that is continuously reproduced in society to show how and where the interrelationship works. Althusser posed question whether ideology is state-sponsored project by drawing a frame of repressive and ideological apparatuses in tangible terms. According to Althusser, ideological state apparatuses being the site of class struggle correspond to the common domain, a middle path to be found out by progressive or revolutionary class. Earlier, church, temple, mosque was one of the state apparatuses for us, now school. The most abiding instrument of producing the ruling ideology has been given the responsibility in reproducing the relations of production in education that brings forth technicians, army men, supervisors, clerks, administration, analysts, scientists, thinkers, and philosophy who cater to the interest of the ruling class. According to Marx, ideology can be seen in negative terms, unreal and outside human history, whereas Althusser propagates ideology in affirmative terms, as an agency that satisfies the material reality. He writes, "And I shall point out that these practices are governed by the rituals in which these practices are inscribed. Within the material existence of an ideological apparatus, be it only a small part of that apparatus, a small mass in a small church, a funeral, a minor match at a sports club, a school day, a political meeting, etc." Here, Althusser emphasizes the rituals and practices that state apparatuses uphold to become a state subject. Central to the formation of ideology, Althusser sees recognition as one of the important steps in the interpellation of individuals. All ideology hails or interpellates concrete individuals as concrete subjects. A police officer hails an individual, "Hey, you there," and the individual turns round to find that he/she becomes the subject. Ideological state apparatus such as church, education, police interpellate subjects to find in subjectivity in a particular fashion by constructing individual self-consciousness. So, we can see that individuals are born into ideology and they find subjectivity, which is constructed by ideology in Althusser's language or discourse, as in Foucault, with in their assurance of family, society, to advocate it, since it gives them a sense of identity and security through language, social system, and conventions. Christian religious ideology interpolated subjects by the ISA, ideological state apparatuses of the church that advocates the concept of God and to obey God. The idea of hell and heaven and its punishment in terms of deeds committed by individuals, etc., and also leads us to think that we are free to our submission of thought and action. Althusser opines, "I shall suggest then that ideology acts or functions in such a way that it recruits subjects among the individuals. It recruits them all or transforms the individuals into subjects by that very precise operation which I have called interpellation or hailing, and which can be imagined along the lines of the most commonplace everyday police or hailing. Hey, you there, Lenin and Philosophy and Other Essays in page 174. The construction of ideology in its workings contain a duality of subject relationship in the interpolating ideology, where individual carries out his, her certain practices through rituals and not an acts of acquiescence, but actions she chooses to be the other subject. These social codes and conventions, systems of thought and practice are never interviewed and questioned, since recognition provided by ideology is equated with misrecognition. Althusser argues, we should note that all this procedure to set up Christian religious subjects is dominated by a strange phenomenon. The fact that there can only be such a multitude of possible religious subjects on the absolute condition that there is a unique absolute other subject, that is God. Althusser speaks of social practice, by which he means the several practices, namely economic, literary, political, ideological, that form the practice of literary production. He defines it, "By practice in general, I shall mean any process of transformation of a determinate given raw material into a determinate product, a transformation effected by a determinate human labor using determinate means of production. In any practice thus considered, the determinant moment is neither the raw material nor the product, but the practice in the narrow sense, the moment of the labor of transformation itself, which sets to work in a specific structure, men, means, and a technical method of utilizing the means." Walter Benjamin, a German Marxist theorist, came up with technological developments and new mass media technologies and forms. To find the radically reformed status and role of arts that shattered originality, the unparalleled status of the work of art in cultural sphere embedded in cultural policies. Central to the hegemonic control in art, Benjamin hailed a technological and revolutionary transformation in the oeuvres of artistic creations. Benjamin deciphered the relationship between art and technology in some seminal essays like A Small History of Photography, The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, and The Paris Letters, published in 1936. What Benjamin developed in connection with art, technology, and policies are some new concepts like aura, reproductibility, and monumental. Aura is the esoteric sense that encompasses artistic or ritual objects like a ring of light or halo that is ruined by techniques of mechanical reproduction such as photography. He writes in The Work of Art in the Age of Mechanical Reproduction, that which withers in the age of mechanical reproduction is the aura of the work of art. This is a symptomatic process whose significance points beyond the realm of art. One might generalize by saying the technique of reproduction detaches the reproduced object from the domain of tradition. In another essay on some motifs in Baudelaire, included in Illuminations, he entitled aura as the associations which at home in the memory involontaire tended to cluster around the object of perception. Here, Marcel Proust's division between involuntary and voluntary recollection and the concept which is attributed to Freud that memory fragments are most effective since the incident on which they are positioned never come into consciousness. Benjamin describes not only the shattering effect but also the liberating potential in paradigm progress of technology to have a mimetic interaction with cosmos just like the children's engagement with their surroundings. He emphasizes the historical development of art through magical and cultic analysis of objects, through sacred function of religion, and to secularization of the religiosity in the manifestation of beauty in art, that is the history of auratic art. He writes, we know that the earliest artworks originated in the service of a ritual first, the magical, then the religious kind. It is significant that the existence of the work of art with reference to its aura is never entirely separated from its ritual function. In other words, the unique value of the authentic work of art has its basis in ritual. The location of original uses value. This ritualistic basis, however remote, is still recognizable as secularized ritual even in the most profane forms of the cult of beauty. The cultic artifact, the aura, appears to rest on something autonomous and free from the ideological control or human interference. With the coming of modernity, the cult of aura disappears, and the banality of bourgeois capitalism stands tall. Apart from photography, Benjamin argues about the revolutionary potential of film as a mode of mechanical reproduction. Film actors do not face the audiences like performers on stage. Audience no longer contemplate film, rather film consumes. Thoughts of individuals remain disjuncted and the moving images hinder the structure of perception. Let us compare the screen on which a film unfolds with the canvas of a painting. The painting invites the spectator to contemplation. Before it, the spectator can abandon himself to his associations. Before the movie frame, he cannot do so. No sooner has his eyes grasped the scene than it is already changed. It cannot be arrested. The spectator's process of association in the view of these images is indeed interrupted by the constant, sudden change. This constitutes the shock effect of the film, which, like all shocks, should be cushioned by heightened presence of mind. By means of its technical structure, the film has taken the physical shock effect out of the wrappers in which Dadaism had, as it were, kept it inside the moral shock effect. Mass consumption leads to the obliteration of aura, and the loss of aura culminates in the potential to open up the politicization of art. Under the new conditions of production and consumption of art, the rebellious potential of art can become instrumental through which the false consciousness of modern man may be overthrown. Technological change attempts to facilitate the politicization of art rather than the introduction of aesthetics into political life. Technology provides individuals the kind of art that requires less concentration in the systems of authenticity. Central to the transformation of individual into a collective body, a matrix from which all traditional behavior toward works of art issues today in a new form brings a close parallel between the mass as viewer and the massive quality of reproductions between the viewer and the viewed in a broader framework of the political character of art and in the dynamic character of technology. Art is politicized when it challenges the authority we obey. In the epilogue to the essay, Benjamin opines that technology appears as an opportunity whose potential can be now related more explicitly to the aestheticization of tendencies of fascism. Mankind, which in Homer's time was an object of contemplation for the Olympian gods, is now one for itself. Its self-alienation has reached such a degree that it can experience its own destruction as aesthetic pleasure of the first order. This is the situation of politics which fascism is rendering aesthetic. Communism responds by politicizing art. The inevitable disappearance of the auratic art in accordance with mass reproduction that changes the nature of a work of art and the politicization of art and its transformation into the dissolution of aesthetic aura, as well as the emancipatory potential of mass culture, particularly film, arrest us to the fetishization of the growing reverence of technology in interpretation of cultural phenomena. In his essay, The Author as Producer, Benjamin, being a sympathizer to modernism, holds that revolutionary action cannot reflect traditional forms if it hopes to usher in social change, and diagnoses the relation between artistic production and politics, between the techniques used in the production of a work of art under the political orientation. He was sensitive to the very impact of technology with an aim to erase the capitalist artifacts only to access political liberation. His primary concern was with the fate of art within capitalist modernity, with the Marxist critique of commodity, culture with a critical representation of the urban environment. Jonathan Dollimore, a social theorist in the fields of Renaissance literature, gender, queer theory, art, censorship, and cultural theory, has developed the concept of the perverse dynamic that stresses the importance of sexual formulations of perversion out of early religious understandings and structures which were at work in the culture of early modernity. The relation between civilization and perversion is a complex one. Dollimore writes, there is something counter-effective in the very mechanism of repression and indeed within the entire civilizing process. Instead of transforming perverse desire into civilized achievement, it counterproductively coerces the subject into a perverse or neurotic existence. It is the production of perversion within the problematic of sexual deviance, the return of the suppressed, what Dollimore calls transgressive reinscription in Western culture. Dollimore uses Freud's theory of civilization, that is a kind of superstructure built upon the base of repressed, perverse instincts that will come again within the official domain of culture, weakening in traditions, disrupting its hierarchies of values, and introducing an element of conflict which cannot be resolved within the dialectic of civilization. Dollimore and Sinfield, with their co-edited collection, Political Shakespeare, Essays in Cultural Materialism, has proved that cultural materialism in Britain and new historicism in America constitute a new academic order in the Renaissance studies. According to them, culture in cultural materialism is analytic, scientific, rather than evaluative, since it does not transcend the material forces and the relations of production. Dollimore and Sinfield argue that cultural materialism has a political leaning of a commitment to the transformation of a social order, which exploits people on the grounds of race, gender, and class. Dolimo stresses the importance of optional modes of textual analysis in the material mechanisms of cultural production. Individual authors and texts are no longer autonomous entity. Rather, Dolimo denied believing that the real struggle is always elsewhere than in the text, and suggested that many strugglers are not textual. Sinfield offers a brief summary of the function of cultural materialism. Cultural materialists investigate the historical conditions in which textual representations are produced, circulated, and received. They engage with questions about the relations between dominant and subordinate cultures, the scope for subaltern resistance, and the modes through which the system tends to accommodate or repel different kinds of dissidents. In this approach, the terms art and literature are neither spontaneous nor innocent. They are strategies for conferring authority upon certain representations and hence upon certain viewpoints. Dolimo's major focus of sexual dissidence is observed at the points where cultural materialism and a frame of references, biography, literary and cultural theory, theodicy, social history, psychoanalysis, philosophy, feminism, and lesbian and gay studies intersect with, but sometimes could also contest each other. But Dolimo has shown some earnest desire in the study of death and desire in Western culture, from classical antiquity to the present. Though his death, desire, and loss in Western culture is stimulated by the cultural politics, it succumbs more to a cultural materialism, material mechanisms of cultural production. Dolimo insisted on cultural materialism's commitment to the reversal of the entire social structure. In analyzing the relation of literature to history, in which historical aspects are dissected not merely as the backdrop of the text, but as being embedded in some ways through textual interests and discourses, cultural materialism shows how meaning is not timeless, but the variegated product of several ideological and discursive structures. Space and time with the fractures of ideology and subversion of power. As long as we live in a society that is governed by capitalist economy, ideology, perversion, dominant and subordinate cultures, and dynamic character of technology, we will not be able to understand the literature and culture of that society without thinkers like Althusser, Benjamin, and Dolimo. So we have today discussed culture, ideology, and technology in the light of contributions made by Althusser, Walter Benjamin, and Jonathan Dolimo. And we have discussed, among several things, you know, we have talked about ideology, recognition, social practices, censorship, religion, and, you know, the kind of perversion that happens in civilization. So we have looked at these things a little bit. For more information, you can log on to the EPG Parchala site and get more help that you want. Thank you so much.